This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book, Life with Mother by Clarence Day. Chapter 1. Mother reads my article to father. There has been some discussion in the Day family, among its members and friends, of the things that I say about father and mother. One of their objections is that in several places I haven't been accurate. I have tried to be, but memories are sometimes inexact, and mine is no exception. However, these pieces have been subjected to a great deal of scrutiny, helpful and otherwise, from members of the family who have sometimes remembered things differently. Cousin Julia, for instance, insists that mother's musicales occurred in the evening, whereas I have described one as taking place in the late afternoon. I feel sure that in this case I am right, for we used to write each other long letters about family doings, and these have given me contemporary accounts of the scenes I've described. Other scenes have come down through the years as family anecdotes. Since I was an actor in most of them, they have remained dramatically printed on my mind. Besides, any memories of two such persons as father and mother are bound to be vivid. The other family objection is that in printing these stories, I have not been decently reticent. My feeling was that these two persons were so utterly themselves, so completely natural and true, that the only good way to tell about them was to paint them just as they were. The first article one printed about them was written one night when I needed an extra paragraph for a column which I was occasionally writing that year for the literary supplement of the New York Evening Post. On a visit to father and mother one summer, I found that they had a new dog. He was leading a happy and interesting life with them, but a somewhat bewildered one too. I had made a note in my diary of the following instance. My father is fond of dogs. Likes to train them. His method is this. He says to the new dog, "Good Jackie," or whatever the name is. The dog wags his tail. "Come here," says my father. "Come here, boy." The dog looks at him doubtfully. My father, who hasn't a great deal of patience, raises his voice. "Come. Come here, sir." The dog grows alarmed and tries to get out. My father advances upon him, repeating, "Come here," with increasing annoyance and sternness. "I wish you'd let Jackie alone," says my mother. "He doesn't know what you want of him." "Pooh. Of course he does," declares my father. "He knows damn well. Come here, sir." And he drags the new dog from under the sofa. "Sit up," he instructs him. The dog is utterly limp. "Sit up. Come. Sit up." He shakes his finger at him. "Sit up, sir." "Oh, please don't," says my mother. "How can you expect the poor thing to sit up when he doesn't know a word that you're saying?" "Will you let me alone?" shouts my father. "Sit up, sir. Sit up." My mother goes to the door. "I'll not stay here and see that dog frightened to death." "Frightened," my father says testily. "What nonsense. I know dogs. They all like me." The dog sees the door being opened and suddenly bolts. My father grabs fiercely at him. In vain. "Confound it," he says in a passion. "Now see what you've done. You've spoiled my whole plan." He stamps. "You could never," my mother begins. "I could," roars my father. "But I can't do a thing if I'm interfered with. Where's that dog gone?" "Jackie. Here, Jackie. Come here, sir." I copied this fragment out of my diary, tucked it in as a filler, and when it appeared, I showed it to mother. "I remember that day," she said. "That's just the way he always treats dogs." She hurried off with the clipping to where father was, in the library. "Here, Claire," she said triumphantly, "read this." Father read it in his usual slow, careful, methodical way, taking note of each word. He looked up at mother with a smile of satisfaction and sympathy. "I hope you'll behave yourself after this," he chuckled. "That's just how you kept interfering with my training that dog." This emboldened me to try my hand at describing a few other incidents of our family life, scenes which I felt were too good to remain buried forever. They came out in Harper's. Every time one appeared, it became a subject of debate between father and mother. For some reason or other, perhaps because they were without self-consciousness, the publicity seemed to be of small or no concern to them, so long as each felt I had been strictly accurate and presented his or her side so clearly that the other should blush. Neither of them ever did blush, however. They got so provoked at each other once or twice because of this that they went back and refought the whole battle. These sketches were read by other persons, friends of theirs, including some who had felt rather buffeted, when they had been our guests, by the sudden indoor squalls or tornadoes that characterized our family life. They told me that these stray fragments had made them understand Father better. Strangers wrote to me that this or that member of their own families was very much like Father. The effect upon most of these readers was to enroll them as Father's friends. So a few years after Father and Mother died, I began again describing old scenes. These characters may or may not be father and mother. All I can say is that they are father and mother as I saw them. End of the chapter. Chapter 2. Mother and Father Meet. Father, although spirited and jolly, was a clear-eyed and careful young man. He was methodical about arranging his life, step by step. He did things one at a time. Until he got married, he continued to live with his parents. He ate out a good deal, but he didn't approve of living in lodgings. It would have made him feel lonely, and he saw no reason to set up a home of his own until he had a wife to put in it. He was a self-reliant young man, however. He had made his own way from the start. It wasn't until he was 21, and had nearly 7 years' business experience that he asked any favors of Grandpa, and all he then asked for was a loan of $3,000, at 6%, to buy a seat on the stock exchange. This was in 1866. He and another young man, Fisher Johnson, formed a firm of their own, and by the time Father was 25, he was becoming well-seasoned. He had gone through the panic of 69 and Black Friday, and had begun to make money. He then started in to arrange the other sides of his life. One of the first things he did was to throw out the furniture that his parents had put in his bedroom and buy and install a set to his liking, a solid brown walnut bed and bureau, chiffonier, chairs and table that he used for the next 40 years. This set also included a carved upright desk with places for his files and account books. His next step was to buy a little clavier keyboard and learn finger exercises. When he had exercised his fingers enough to warrant it, he bought a piano and hired an old German musician to teach him how to play. What with Father's intolerance of the old family furniture, and his criticisms of old family ways, and his pounding determinedly night after night on his piano, Grandpa began to get restive. But Grandma, to whom Grandpa was silently but deeply devoted, interceded for Father every time things came to a head and managed from one day to another to smooth Grandpa down. Grandpa tried to be patient, on the theory that his son would soon marry. Father seemed to be planning to propose to a cousin of his who lived in West Springfield. They must have had some understanding between them, for he gave her a ring and a watch. But they soon had a quarrel. They decided they had made a mistake, and the ring was returned. Disappointing as this was to Grandpa, it did not interrupt Father's program. It merely changed a little the order of the steps he was planning. He joined a club and went there regularly to see other men and play billiards. He disliked to visit ordinary billiard parlors. He had made up his mind they were low. As to drinking, he took wine with his dinner, and beer or ale with his lunch, but he didn't drink at bars or between meals because that was a poor way to do it. In 1869 he found that he could get away for a few months from business, and he thereupon treated himself to a vacation abroad. He had several things to attend to in Europe. He went to the best watchmaker in Switzerland and selected a watch so much to his taste that he wore it for the rest of his life. It was a solid, good-looking gold watch with a cover that Father had to snap open, and it had to be wound with a key. When I was a young man, it seemed out of date, but it kept perfect time. After getting just the right watch, he went to London to get proper clothes. The one place that you could rely on to know all about clothes was Poole's. Father ordered only enough clothes at Poole's for his immediate needs, but he left them his measurements, and thus felt this whole matter satisfactorily settled and off his mind, like his watch and his furniture. From that time on, Poole sent him samples of cloths every year, and Father ordered a suit or an overcoat or whatever he needed. He took good care of his clothes, and he never had many at once, but they had to be right. The only trouble was that in later years, when he put on more weight, and when he went to England less frequently, Poole's clothes didn't fit. A sturdy, well-made box would arrive, through the customs, and underneath all the layers of tissue paper would be a handsome dress suit. Upon trying to force himself into it, Father didn't feel comfortable, the damn thing wouldn't button. He would thereupon get into a cab with this suit, and go to his Fifth Avenue tailor, a most supercilious man, to whom Father never gave any business except repairs or refittings. He would unwillingly alter Poole's things as directed, at the same time pointing out to Father, without any effect, that he would do much better to buy his clothes in New York in the first place. In reply, Father would admonish the tailor to make a better job of the alterations than he had last time, and he would add that he would be glad to buy his things in New York as soon as he could find any tailor here who knew how to make clothes. Each time he went abroad, he would revisit Poole and adjure him to get his measurements right, and after that, at least for a year or two, there would be a season of peace when everything that arrived fitted him perfectly, and when the Fifth Avenue tailor was given no work to do except to clean and repair Poole's new masterpieces. But after a while, Father would gain a few pounds again. This was always an unwelcome surprise, and he disliked to admit to himself it was true. Although he never skimped himself on his food, he thought that he ate very little. So whenever new difficulties came upon him, trying to button Poole's clothes, he would never send Poole any new measurements. He didn't see how he could have changed. At the most, he would mention when he wrote that the clothes shouldn't be so damn tight. This worried Poole, who hated to guess as to where and how to make changes. Father came back from his first trip to Europe with his watch and his good clothes from Poole, like a Columbus who had discovered a pleasant and useful new world. He had taken his ease in its cities. He had enjoyed the orderly loveliness of The Hague and the solid richness of London, and everywhere he had seen what taste and time could do for homes in the country. He had no wish to live among Europeans, for he looked down on them, somehow, but he respected them too for the contributions they had made to his comfort. He was especially charmed with their cookery, their wines, and their manners. The next year, 1870, when he was 25, he went over again. He wanted to see more of Europe. He also wanted some shirts. Sailings in those days were early. Father arrived at the dock at 7 a.m. and looked over the ship. It was the Saint Laurent of the French line, an iron vessel of 3,000 tons, painted a soft gray and green and equipped with 8 lifeboats. A liner of 9 or 10,000 tons is considered tiny today, and most of them are from 20 up, but the Saint Laurent seemed stately to Father with her tall masts and white sails. She was rigged as a bark, but she had engines too, of course. They were of over 900 horsepower. Also, grand innovation pour l'époque, she was one of the new type of ships, equipped with a little iron propeller instead of side paddle wheels. There was a great crowd on the dock, or what seemed like one in 1870, for this splendid ship had accommodation for 200 first cabin passengers. As Father made his way on board, past the bulky flounces and skirts of the ladies, he saw a man he had met on the stock exchange, Alden B. Stockwell. Red mustache, bushy flowing red whiskers, 10 years older than Father, a dignified and powerful man who had come to New York from Ohio. Alden Stockwell was saying goodbye to his brother, Levi, and to their little sister, who was 17 but who still wore her hair in a red braid down her back. Girls were younger at 17 then than now. They were kept in school until the very last minute, when they suddenly came out as young ladies. Father was introduced to Levi Stockwell and this schoolgirl, his future wife, and the Saint Laurent sailed. Levi got seats for the three of them together at table, so that his little sister wouldn't have to sit next to some stranger. This was an exceedingly agreeable arrangement for a sociable young man like Father, who liked company but who was too formal to pick up acquaintances. Everybody was formal. Even upon a ship, men preserve the habits of society, a Frenchman of the 70s wrote. They are careful of their dress, their manners, their conversation, the effect they may produce upon others. Each strives to assume his most distinguished air. The ladies, who, thanks to the privileges which custom readily grants them, are always impenetrable even to those who are their acquaintances, become even more impenetrable on a voyage, among the wraps, the shawls, the thick veils which transform them into traveling sphinxes. There were a number of South American passengers on board the Saint Laurent, dark and talkative men who couldn't speak English. They chattered on deck day and night, volubly and rapidly, and sometimes they woke Father up. It annoyed him. He told Levi Stockwell, he told everybody he met, what an infernal nuisance these Spaniards were getting to be. Levi said nothing, but the next morning he got up very early. The decks were deserted. He took up his stand just outside the open porthole of Father's cabin, and putting his mouth as close to it as he dared, he rapidly repeated all the Spanish words that he could think of. There were less than a dozen, but he muttered them over and over. The effect was one of a bevy of Spaniards engaged in an endless dispute. Levi, who was keeping his ear cocked, soon heard sounds inside Father's cabin, where a sleepy young man was loudly saying damn to himself in his berth. Levi's Spanish instantly became low and soothing. Father's muttering stopped. But after he had had time to go back to sleep, the Spanish voices again grew excited, and they soon became so noisy and urgent that Father sprang out of bed. "I swear those fellows gabble all night," he said to little Miss Stockwell at breakfast. Strange to say, this Mr. Day had a letter of introduction to Dr. George Parmley of Paris, who was one of the Stockwell family's own cousins, and the one Mother later loved best. But as to whether she liked this Mr. Day, she seemed far from sure. One day he called to the waiter, "Here, bring that back, I want some more, that is good." Mother told him, "There are other people here besides you." "He makes me so mad," she wrote her mother. Young Mr. Day didn't mind that in the least. He found this schoolgirl great fun. He promenaded the deck with her on breezy days, with her veils flying and her skirts billowing out, and on foggy days he placed her chair where the cordage and yards wouldn't drip on her. He brought her hot cups of tea. And when the weather grew rough and she was too ill to stir, he and Levi took turns carrying her up on deck for a breath of fresh air. The air wasn't good down below. Even that Frenchman, when he wrote of his travels, spoke about the closed portholes. "At night," he said, "the atmosphere below is warm and heavy, and silence reigns, only broken by the regular breathing of the sleepers." The Saint Laurent made 11 or 12 knots in good weather, but only about 6 in storms, and by the time she reached port, Father had definitely attached himself to the two Stockwells. Flowers and trees were in bloom when they landed. They went to spend May in Paris. And in between seeing sights with his new friends, Father did what he'd come for. He went to Jourdain at Brown's shop in the Rue Halévy and had himself measured for shirts. He got his shirts, socks, and handkerchiefs from them most of the rest of his life. The handkerchiefs were always plain white with white monograms on them, but the French socks were sometimes very gay and lively in color for Father, who was in all other respects most conservative in his manner of dressing. I think he permitted himself to wear them because he thought they were hidden. As with his clothes, Father had trouble with his shirts in later life, for he began to get thick in the neck, and he had to stretch his throat violently to get his French shirts to button. They were stiff white shirts made open front and with stiff standing collars attached, and he got very red in the face getting into them, dressing for dinner at night. They were made in such a way, as was then the custom, that he had to pull them on over his head. He would thrust his arms out through the sleeves and come bursting out at the top. The cuffs were stiff, of course, and had rounded corners. At times when the fashion changed, cuffs would be made with square corners for years, but not father's. His cuffs had originally been rounded, and rounded they stayed. Also, on every one of his shirts, all his life, there was a little starch tab with a buttonhole in it in front at the waistline. The original purpose of these was to hold up a man's drawers, but father never used them for that or for anything else. Yet, late in his life, when he was finally driven to order some shirts in New York, and when Caskell objected to putting tabs on, asking what they were for, father said roundly that he didn't happen to remember, but he wanted them put on just the same. In his old age, his sons used to urge him to wear soft shirts and be comfortable, at least in the country in summer. He finally consented to try one. But before putting it on, he examined this outlandish thing with a frown, and went down to breakfast very slowly in it, feeling, he said, indecent. By lunchtime he had gone back upstairs again, and put on a stiff one. On the night that father came back from his first trip to Jourdain at Brown's, when he went in to dinner, Levi refused to shake hands with him. Levi was carefully holding on to his right hand, as though it were some precious object. He would allow no one to touch it. He could never use it to shake hands with common people again, he declared, or with anyone else except monarchs, because that hand had been shaken that very afternoon by the emperor. Some fellow officer had introduced Levi to the court at the races. 2 months later, war had suddenly broken out. The Battle of Sedan had been fought, and the emperor was being led away as a prisoner in the hands of the Germans. By the following January, the Parisians were eating cats, eating horses, and hungrily paying a franc apiece even for rats. But nobody dreamed of these terrible things in Paris that spring. Levi Stockwell hurried around attending to the matters of business in which his brother Alden was interested, and their little red-headed sister went out walking with young Mr. Day. He and she visited the galleries and cathedrals together. They drove together to pay their respects to good Dr. George Parmley, and just as those new shirts were ready and he was preparing to leave, young Mr. Day began to discover that he had fallen in love. Chapter 3. Father Visits the War. Mother was only 8 years old in April 1861 when the Civil War started, but all her four brothers were older, and two of them went to the front. Brutus Stockwell, the youngest, was away at school in France. Alden, the eldest, was tied up in business in Cleveland, where the first shiploads of ore had begun to arrive from the Great Lakes. But Levi got a commission in the Navy, and served under Farragut, and Norris was one of the youngest captains of infantry to march with Sherman through Georgia. All four brothers were lively by nature, athletic red-headed men. The Stockwells lived in Ohio, the Days in New York, and in the 60s the two families never had heard of each other. Physically, they were rather alike. Father was athletic and lively, and he had red hair too, but he was only 16 when the war began and Grandpa didn't want him to go. Grandpa, though he had voted for Lincoln, had hoped that war wouldn't come, and when it did come he was disgusted, but Grandpa was 50. Father wasn't disgusted, he was interested and pleased. He was working downtown in New York, in Gwynn and Day's office, the firm in which his elder brother was the junior partner. In the evenings when he came home from business, he sat by the lamp in his bedroom and made elaborate drawings of soldiers in one of his schoolboy notebooks. I found it among his papers years afterward, a thick, square, well-made old blank book, full of sums in arithmetic and clippings from Civil War newspapers and drawings by Father of Cannon and bearded Zouaves. Father's patriotism, however, was tempered with humor, and he seems to have been extraordinarily tickled by the fun Grandpa made of top lofty patriots. At any rate, he cut out many of the most biting articles that Grandpa kept publishing, and pasted them in that fat blank book, alongside his own warlike drawings. When Father was 17, he decided to join the old 7th Regiment. It was characteristic of him to look over the ground before he did anything, and then do it in what he considered the very best way, and the seventh was generally regarded as the best in the country. Its ranks were full, he found, at the armory, but vacancies occurred now and then, because as there was a shortage of officers in the new armies, the older members of the seventh, even the privates, were in demand for these jobs. It was about the nearest thing that they had, in the 60s, to an officer's training corps. Father put his name down on the waiting list and went back to his office. Half the best young men in New York wanted to get into the seventh. Even the newspapers in London had spoken admiringly of the world-renowned 7th Regiment. And when President Buchanan made a speech to them, before the election of Lincoln, he had felt so moved that he said, "The stout, hardy, noble, and defiant look which you exhibit shows that in the day and hour of battle you would be at the very front." The 7th had tried to get to the very front when the war started. It had sprung to arms and gone to the defense of Washington as soon as Sumter was fired on. A week later, however, when all real danger to the city was over, and plenty of other troops had arrived, the 7th felt that its object had been accomplished, and that it might as well go back home. At this point, the government asked it to enlist for 3 months in the army. This didn't seem fair to the 7th. They had been distinctly assured when they started that they would only be away for 2 weeks. They at once held a meeting, however, and voted on this. They decided to enlist as a body and to serve 30 days. When this 30-day period was over, the men entrained and came home. The lower classes made unpleasant remarks about their return, but the regiment was welcomed all the more warmly by all the best citizens. In 1862, when Stonewall Jackson burst into the Shenandoah Valley, and it looked as though he might capture Washington, the government requested the 7th to help out again. By this time, Father had been elected a member. He got a leave of absence from Gwynne and Day, and went off as a private in Company D. Unfortunately, at least from Father's point of view, Stonewall Jackson subsided, and instead of seeing action in the field, the 7th was put into barracks near Baltimore. And as though this wasn't bad enough, the Secretary of War then requested the regiment, instead of enlisting for 30 days this time, to stay for 3 months. Nobody liked the prospect of sitting there for 3 months in barracks. Father wrote to his mother that his company had been sent to Mount Clare Station, where they slept in the open, and as it was damp and cold, he added, "I wish you would send me a colored nightcap and some seggers." It wasn't certain whether the regiment would be willing to stay on or not. "I don't think I could stay," Father wrote, "on account of my business, for I don't think Gwynne and Day could very well spare me for as long as that." He was 17, going on 18, and here he was already talking this way and smoking seggers. In his next letter, he sounds somewhat younger. "I hope it will be over with soon," he wrote, "as I shall not stay more than a month, but that is not saying I'm homesick, for I can get along very well. I received your box of things yesterday. The cake, etc., was very much appreciated in our mess, and also the lemons, with which I made some lemonade last night, and it tasted first rate, as I was very thirsty, and the water is not very good, being limey, which is not grammatically correct but still will express what I wish to say. About 12 o'clock night before last, it commenced raining and rained all day yesterday in perfect torrents, and most of last night. My tent got pretty well water-soaked, and commenced leaking, and in an hour or so the floor was as wet as thunder, and we had to huddle all together to keep dry, and even in that manner we got very damp. I tell you, Mother, boards are a perfect luxury, at least I thought so when we got our board floor up last Sunday, after sleeping 2 or 3 nights in wet straw. We have our tent fitted up very nicely. At the end opposite the door is a musket rack with a shelf on top, then there are 2 bunks on each side, and 1 directly in front, in which I sleep. The bunks, by the by, consist of a knapsack for a pillow, and a blanket spread out on the floor. From the top of the tent, we have suspended 2 shelves, one under the other, on which we put our dishes, and in the center we have a table, all of which we made ourselves, so we think a great deal of them on that account. I wish you would send some lemons, oranges, ginger snaps, cake, and if possible a nice pie, which last luxury I have not seen.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.